Support for this program provided by Ty Cobb Regional Healthcare Center, located in Livonia, Georgia, serving the Lake Hartwell community. Additional support from the University of Georgia President's Venture Fund, the UGA Graduate School, the Franklin College of Arts and Sciences, and the Performing Arts Center at UGA.
Russia's music is as iconic as its architecture. It captures the Russian soul. Now, music never played outside Russia's borders comes to the West for the first time.
That information came from
scores that lay dormant for centuries, rediscovered in a former Russian mansion turned archived.
And that's where we really started, you know, cracking manuscripts open.
How University of Georgia conductors became modern-day detectives on a treasure hunt for musical masterpieces.
Every day there was a staggering event. It was just sort of mind-blowing in a way.
How they walk in the footsteps of Russian royalty in Russia's most dazzling cities.
Fountains of water everywhere and gold abound.
What surprises they find on a journey back in history. Plus, what they discover about Russia today. Join us for the first American performances of The Music for the Tsars. There's a tangible electricity, an emotional pitch. Backstage at the University of Georgia's Performing Arts Center.
The choir members, we don't need them.
Especially for Blake Unger, a conductor in training.
It gets a little stressful back here, but that's what we feed off of. That's the hype. That's the cool part about it.
Rossini.
All the preparation and the practice is amplified.
I think performers always have that kind of combination of nervous energy before they go on. I think if you don't have that, you might not be breathing.
These music students understand they will soon take part in history.
This concert is, as you probably noticed already in the program, and you'll hear much more through the evening, in many ways a culmination of some work that was accomplished over the summer in a research trip to Russia.
I had never been before. Has anyone in the audience ever been to Russia?
Director of UGA Bands, Dr. John Lynch, was one of five people who journeyed to Russia to bring back music never performed in America.
And we've brought back three pieces for you to hear for the first time in the West, and you're about to hear one of them. This is the earliest piece that we found in this wonderful collection of Russian band music. This piece dates from the early 1800s and is written for a chamber choir and a small chamber group of harmony music instruments. It's a female composer of nobility, which is also quite interesting. It's a delightful piece, and it's very much in the style of a Mozart opera, except all the words are in Russian. We had quite the time figuring that one out.
The UGA Hudson Singers and University Chorus had the difficult task of learning Russian choral parts from the early 1800s.
It takes me back to the trip this summer and also transports me back a little bit as much as possible, as we can imagine what things were like in the days of the Tsars.
The discoveries culminated in a concert in Athens, Georgia, where a modern-day audience enjoyed music once intended to delight the Tsars. The concert was appropriately titled From the Land of the White Knights, Music of the Tsars and Beyond.
Thank you.
There's something about the light that I think would be really appealing to a painter, for instance, because the sky and the clouds so crisp and clear and vivid, and it brings all the colors of the building to life.
The city's high latitude means the sun rarely dips below the horizon in summertime, resulting in nearly round-the-clock daylight.
Oh my gosh, it feels like it's 6 in the evening, but it's really like 10 or 11 o'clock.
It was during the season of white nights when a small contingent from Athens, Georgia, journeyed to St. Petersburg, Russia.
I took a picture and put it on my Twitter feed of the airport billboard, just the incoming and outgoing flights and the numbers. And if we didn't have the number of our flight, I would have never known where it was because you can't read any of the cities. And I was like, how are we gonna get out of here? And I'm like, oh, 307 or whatever number we are. There's 307, let's go that way.
Will you be in the front?
Dr. Lynch would arrive with 3 graduate students, all aspiring conductors.
And I sense a real pride in their country here, and really a pride about what they believe in and their traditions. You know, just driving through the city, you see statues and monuments and churches that just all bring to life the long, rich history that Russia has.
Oh, you know, the first day being in St. Petersburg, we're seeing all the churches and how the domes were all different styles and different colors. There's one very simple kind of rustic color with a big dome, and there's one that had all gold, which probably represented had all money. It was very European.
St. Petersburg has a European flourish. It is the country's cultural capital. Tourists journey up and down its network of canals and rivers, soaking in landmarks that showcase the grandeur of the Russian Empire. But ordinary streets also brought extraordinary insights.
So shops and apartments, yeah, Igor?
Yeah.
We're going to the mall to meet, you know, this person. It looks like a shopping center on the inside, and on the outside it looks like this army bunker. There's barbed wire and fences and gates to get in and out and all this stuff. And yeah, so that was unexpected, to see stuff that doesn't, it's not serving its original purpose. Everything over there seemed repurposed, and we're very not used to that here in the States.
Those cultural differences would deepen over the course of this group's journey. So would an appreciation of universal languages like art and music. But it would be the history, a brush with genius past, that would make the greatest impression.
Okay, guys, this is the original score of the Rossini.
Oh, good. We went back to the Omega, and I had it in my hands, and so, I mean, it was fascinating to see just his hands had touched it, his ink was absorbed into that paper. It was truly remarkable.
It is inside the courts of Russian royalty that the story develops. A tale of 2 czars, a grandfather and grandson, who ruled with an iron fist. And 2 international superstars, musicians who craved those czars' attentions. The lives of these men would intersect at different times in the 19th century, but, like Connect the Dots, researching one would unexpectedly lead to discoveries about another. It would take the detective work of a 21st century history buff in Athens, Georgia, to start unraveling the mysteries of the past.
Dr. George Foreman is the director of the Performing Arts Center at the University of Georgia. He is also a musicologist, one who studies the history and science of music.
The Tsar said, "We have a brass band going."
Touring his research room is like getting a backstage pass into the Band Music Hall of Fame. His bookcases contain thousands of musical scores from famous bandmasters like Patrick Gilmore and John Philip Sousa. But one might not recognize the name of his favorite research subject.
Jules Levy was acknowledged throughout the world, really, as being the preeminent cornet virtuoso of the 1860s, 70s, and 80s. He was an incredibly egotistical person, and he was known wherever he played as the world's greatest cornetist.
Antique instruments fill Dr. Foreman's room. He's a collector. One irresistible purchase was this cornet. A pawn shop dealer placed it on sale via eBay. Dr. Foreman recognized it as a cornet once played by Jules Levy and snapped it up.
This is the plate that has J. Levy.
While originally from England, Levy was treated as a celebrity around the world. Beyond his ability to make beautiful music, musicians admired his technical abilities as a cornet soloist. So, how did Levy end up rubbing shoulders with Russian royalty? In 1871, a member of the Russian Tsar's family came to visit America for the first time. Americans treated Grand Duke Alexis with great fanfare. He even hunted buffalo with the likes of Buffalo Bill Cody and General George Custer. During his visit to New York City, high society welcomed him with parades and parties and serenaded him with the very best music.
But the Grand Duke, the son of the Tsar, showed up on this big tour of the world that he was on, and Levy played for him. He was very taken, you know, and he said, you know, you should go to Russia because my brother plays the cornet. And he was talking about the future Alexander III.
Alexander III was a keen lover of cornet and tuba.
Alexander III was a musically educated man, famous for helping Tchaikovsky in staging operas and other musical plays. And because of his interest in music and musical instruments, he was able to tell what kind of musicians stood before him, what kind of musicians were playing with him.
Even though Alexander III was not yet Tsar, Levy was keen to impress Russian royalty. In 1872, he set off for what was then the imperial capital, St. Petersburg. In an area near Nevsky Prospect, one of St. Petersburg's most bustling and historic streets is the Russian National Library. Dr. Foreman has made four trips to Russia to track down Levy's travels. At his side is Igor Levin. Igor trained as a military band conductor in Russia and is now a trip facilitator. His translations are necessary. Russian newspapers are printed in the Cyrillic alphabet, making it that much more difficult for an American to search for key words. They spy a poster promoting a concert Levy performed in Russia in 1873, a performance previously unknown. Levy performed a series of concerts throughout Russia, including Moscow's World Expo.
And so every one of them we have to defined like that. There's no list. We have to create it. So it's looking. So it's a good day when you find a new one.
The search for Levy and the rediscovery of rare Russian music would intersect at a different archive in St. Petersburg. On a previous trip, Dr. Foreman had gone to pick up information about Levy at the Russian Institute for the History of Arts. It is here, in a room that looks like a cross between a library and grandma's attic, that the work of Russia's most famous composers are kept. Galina Kopitova is a chief archivist and scholar.
We store in our cabinet very precious collections of extremely rare musical manuscripts from the 18th and 19th century. We store materials that belonged to the imperial orchestra.
The institute is housed in a former mansion of a Russian noble family. The Zubovs held high ranks dating back to the 15th century. In 1912, Count Valentin Zubov donated his home to become a library and cultural center. Famous poets and artists held court here during Russia's Silver Age, a period of development for the country's arts and literature. 5 years later, the Russian Revolution erupted. World War II brought more turmoil as Hitler's troops burned much of the mansion's furniture for fuel.
Old palace.
When University of Georgia graduate students arrived at the Institute, they scaled staircases of past grandeur. And entered rooms creased with character.
Beginning of A section.
Go back to the beginning. I want to see what that cornet line is.
Well, I just feel like in the 18th, 19th century, where everything is so decadent with chandeliers, it just brought me back in time, a few centuries, you know.
And artifacts around the room, you know, busts of important Russian composers and cabinets and this big table and, you know, not what we're used to. You know, if you go to the Library of Congress and D.C., you know, everything is pristine. It's not like that at all. It's very rough around the edges, but it added to that whole sense of place, of history.
So this first one, this is the earliest piece.
Dr. Foreman shared with Dr. Lynch and the UGA graduate students what he had stumbled upon, a treasure trove of important and obscure music.
I mean, it was probably kept here in this library. It was used on the occasion it was written for. And just kind of went to sleep, like Rip Van Winkle. And
the UGA team of conductors whisked some scores to a nearby piano, trying to reconstruct the composer's works and imagining the intended audience.
These were major festivals. I mean, we saw the piece today that had large band score and a choir score that would have been performed by hundreds of performers. Very major, you know, ceremonial type of music. So this is really important. You know, it just wasn't, you know, parlor music or anything like that. This was music to celebrate the Russian people and to be played by many and be heard by many.
One piece that was heard by many appears in a highly decorated book. It's part of the fabric of Russian musical heritage. The famous Russian poet Vasily Zhukovsky wrote the lyrics of the Russian national anthem. Prince Alexei Lvov composed it in 1833, autographing his original copy. The original score stirred the students' spirits.
Russian national anthem sung from the autographed manuscript. Doesn't happen every day.
Doubly autographed.
The Russian people sang the anthem entitled God Save the Tsar until the monarchy was toppled in the Russian Revolution of 1917. New leaders then chose a new anthem.
Music is a universal language. It's because it's the only thing, really, that we can communicate through when you think about it. The language doesn't work. The culture is very different. The alphabet's not the same. So the tapping and all that is our grasp for a connection, not just with each other, but with the composer and with the people, with the country. And it's our grasp for connection with this kind of foreign land that we've been dropped into.
Months later, the University of Georgia's Wind Ensemble would perform the anthem for a recording in Athens, Georgia. Performers 180 years ago sang this same anthem to a Tsar on Christmas Day in the most grandiose of places. The royal family's home in St. Petersburg, the Winter Palace.
On December 25th, 1833, the anthem was performed for the first time in the presence of the Tsar at the Winter Palace. This was the anthem used until the Russian Revolution of 1917. The anthem was played before every spectacle, every concert, and every public event.
Tsar Nicholas I was delighted by the anthem chosen to represent Imperial Russia. At over 6 feet tall, he was every inch the representative of Imperial Russia himself, known to possess a commanding presence. When he visited Britain in 1844, Queen Victoria described him:
"He is certainly a very striking man, still very handsome. His profile is beautiful and his manners most dignified and graceful. Extremely civil, quite alarmingly so, as he is full of attentions and politeness. But the expression of his eyes is formidable and unlike anything I ever saw before. He seldom smiles, and when he does, the expression is not a happy one."
Nicholas I never expected to become Tsar. His brother, Tsar Alexander I, died suddenly of typhus, and his brother next in line, Constantine, refused to take the throne. It spurred confusion over who was the rightful ruler. A group of young army officers, later known as the Decembrists, took advantage of that confusion and staged a revolt in 1825. Troops on both sides gathered a few blocks from the Winter Palace in Senate Square. The new Tsar appeared at the square and hesitated for hours to open fire with cannons on the rebellious soldiers. Nicholas turned to commander, saying, "Do you want me to shed the blood of my subjects on the very first day of my reign?" The answer came back, "Yes, to save your empire." Guns roared and rebels fell. While dozens were shot, most were exiled. Five Decembrists were executed and are still memorialized. Nicholas I did not forget the insurrection. From then on, crushing any insubordination and demanding absolute obedience from the masses. He would create a secret police force, expand censorship powers, and ban foreigners and foreign travel. He cut Russia off from the rest of the world. Nicholas I would earn many nicknames, one of them the Iron Tsar.
A huge bronze statue of Nicholas I stands today in St. Petersburg's St. Isaac Square. The sculpture depicts the Tsar as a powerful military leader. In 1859, thousands of people came to watch the statue's unveiling 4 years after the monarch died. The monument was considered a technical wonder in its day, the first statue of a horse in Europe with only two support points. The same architect built another engineering feat across from Tsar Nicholas's statue, St. Isaac's Cathedral. It was the main cathedral of the capital in the 19th century. As a devoutly religious leader, Tsar Nicholas spent enormous sums of money from the Russian treasury to complete the Orthodox structure. The Tsar commissioned specially constructed ships to transport the massive red granite columns from Finland, each column weighing 114 tons. Craftsmen spent 40 years building the cathedral. Today, it remains one of the largest cathedrals in the world. Tourists appear as tiny ants walking around its gold dome. It is a sight that Galina stares at daily in her room with a view. She's able to see the cathedral and the Tsar's statue from the archives at the Russian Institute for the History of Arts. Her guest, a group of conductors from the University of Georgia, excitedly huddle around music once made for the man astride that horse across the street. Music they hope to bring back to America.
And we have this dream of creating a performance edition where we could bring these back to life in the United States so people could hear them, play them.
Their focus is a set of military marches written in Tsar Nicholas's honor, scores created by an Italian opera idol, Gioachino Rossini.
Now, these pieces were composed in 1834, I believe, and Rossini was not he wasn't a kid at that point. He was a mature composer in the prime of his life.
During his lifetime, Rossini composed 39 operas, along with chamber and sacred music. He rode a wave of success after writing such operas as William Tell. And The Barber of Seville. The biographer Stendhal wrote of Rossini's soaring popularity.
Napoleon is dead, but a new conqueror has already shown himself to the world. And from Moscow to Naples, from London to Vienna, from Paris to Calcutta, his name is constantly on every tongue.
Opera blossomed in Russia during the 19th century. Audiences packed St. Petersburg opera houses like the Imperial Bolshoi Kamenny Theater and the Mariinsky Theater.
An Italian troupe came to St. Petersburg during the reign of Nicholas I without the participation of Rossini, and it immediately gained great popularity in Russia. It became the number one opera company. It was where all the aristocrats went, as they could afford such entertainment. But if we are to speak of Tsar Nicholas I, he was not a big opera fan. He was a very reserved and conservative person who was a patron of poetry and music, but did not share the public's taste for the melodrama of the opera.
What Nicholas was a fan of was anything military. He thrived on military drills and parades. So Rossini picked up his pen to please the Tsar, dabbling in a genre he infrequently indulged, military band music.
I believe Rossini composed those marches and gave them as a gift to the Tsar, because he was fishing for an invitation to take an opera company to St. Petersburg and produce operas. The Duke, or Prince, or whoever it was, who approached Rossini about writing the marches, had a different agenda in mind.
That agenda would eventually become clear. Each of the three marches honored a different military event.
Yeah. A Russian army
passes through the mountains.
Marches.
The first march commemorated Russian soldiers marching over the Balkans to Constantinople in 1828.
And that has a lot slower tempo and meaning. Like you've got a sense that it was a journey to get through the passage to conquer it.
Rickey concentrated on the second march. It celebrates a military victory in what is now Central Armenia. In the months to come, he would transform this score into a modern performance edition.
Mine was more lighthearted, more definitely of a celebration. I can imagine fireworks going off while this is being played in some big plaza or something.
But it was the third piece that would really set off political fireworks. In 1830, Polish officers revolted against the Russian Empire in an incident called the November Uprising.
Once the center of democratic thought, and indeed the cultural center of Poland, was crushed and turned into a virtually military garrison. This brutal suppression of the rebels and civilians turned many Europeans against Tsar Nicholas I. In bloody battles, some 8,000 Poles lost their lives.
I think actually the United States government, the Americans, had actually sent funds to help these rebellious Polish people, and the Tsar went in and just really crushed it. And so Rossini was certainly risking his reputation by composing a march for in honor of that.
Galina extensively researched the history surrounding Rossini's creation.
Rossini в России не бывал.
Rossini was never in Russia. He sent these marches from Paris in January of 1834. This was the composer's personal gift to the sovereign. The titles of these marches show that Rossini wanted to please the Emperor of Russia. I assume that Russian diplomats, and in particular the Russian ambassador to Paris, suggested to Rossini to compose these marches to enhance Russia's image in European society, because after the taking of Warsaw, the Russian emperor did not have a good reputation in European circles.
Published in the Times of London.
Curran would tackle this last controversial march for a performance. Recognizing it as pure political spin.
Guy working for Nicholas I thought, hey, if we put this as a name it, this title that honors this event in Warsaw, then hopefully the Russian people won't think it was so bad because it's such a happy sounding march.
Speed? How do you say speed? Tempo?
As conductors, they would debate the right tempo, using cell phones to help get the right beat.
Let's see what that looks like.
The UGA group unraveled clues as to how Rossini wanted each score to sound.
You can see the level of craftsmanship this versus the first couple pieces we looked at.
You almost, in a way, felt a strange connection to the person that wrote it always, you know, just the idiosyncrasies of their penmanship and the splatters on the page, what have you, you know, it's touched by the person that actually wrote this, you know, over a century ago.
Rossini, Gioachino Rossini.
We can take a picture.
Stop.
The thing that struck me is that these are more complicated than a lot of music for wind band from this time. Presumably, they had bands that could play this music at that point, but it's not easy music to play. It would have taken really good players to play those pieces.
But you can see out onto St. Petersburg and you see the architecture. It's not war-torn, it's got a lot of story on it. But I feel like every building in that city, in that country, has some really serious times in its life.
As the UGA graduate students wandered through St. Petersburg's sights, they tried to absorb not only the city's magnificent history, but also present-day culture. They found the younger generation considered Americans quite the novelty. In some instances, they were asked,
"Are you American?" "Yes, I've never met an American before in my entire life." It's like, really? That is so, I mean, it's weird to think, but we just wrongfully assume that everybody knows us and every country has met us.
Describing exactly where home was became tricky.
Coke is one of those universal products all over the world. I think Coke and, you know, they have McDonald's and stuff like that, but Coke is in Atlanta. And I'm like, yeah, have you ever had a Coca-Cola? You know, Coke? And then, oh yeah, Coca-Cola, I know what that is. That's where I'm from.
Throughout Russia, American influence was visible. Even where traditional Russian crafts are sold, visitors could buy Russian nesting dolls, American style.
I learned they value our pop culture. They know more about our movies, our film, our music than sometimes I did. I'm like, oh, you watch Grey's Anatomy? And they all kept asking about that. I'm like, I never really watched it, but yeah, I'm aware of that.
As the students struggled to find cultural connections with Russians, they also discovered significant differences.
I think they're very careful about what they say and do because they are being watched. I remember our hotel having a surveillance person just watching who came in and out of the hallways. It just is a high sense of security and surveillance on everyone. And that's very non-American. I get a sense that everyone is in their own world. There's sort of a, this is a pun, but an iron curtain is still kind of up. Their face was so just stoic. And as it seemed like expression was something you didn't want to do in daylight. But I found that nightlife, though, was way more active, and it was a complete change, day and night, if you will.
Fine dining in St. Petersburg included a smorgasbord of new tastes and flavors.
Sour cream and beets, I'm assuming, and stuffed potatoes with egg and cheese. Traditional for me.
They discussed orchestras and bands with a new friend and fellow conductor, Valentin Lyschenko.
6 to 8 trumpets, 5 horns.
Very nice to meet you.
Thank you very much.
Our other friend.
Valentin is the conductor for the Admiralty Navy Band. His band played for a big crowd during a homecoming on the banks of the Neva River. The occasion? One of the oldest preserved sailing ships, the Setov, sailed into port.
For a year sailing around the world.
The UGA group would get their own chance to conduct the Admiralty Navy Band, a privilege they did not take lightly.
I asked our escort, Igor, so I said, I want to learn 4 words. Louder, softer, faster, slower. So I remember that being a very vivid moment, like, wow, when you strip down all things you have to communicate to a band in rehearsal, it sometimes comes down to those 4 words.
Dr. Lynch and each graduate student had a chance to conduct a different piece with this Russian military band.
Как дела? Yeah? Yeah? Okay. We start easy.
Nonverbal communication became ultimately important.
We go back to the beginning a little bit faster. Yeah? And trombones. Fatter. Fatter.
Curran conducted an American number, Down a Country Lane.
But they played it really well because we brought the parts with us and just handed out the parts, and they sight read right on the spot.
Rickey tried out a Russian march.
Through the brief, 5 to 6 minutes I had with him, I felt like we made some really great music. And part of that too is I chose, music of their heritage, Prokofiev march, and they definitely knew how to play that.
All of the conductors were pleased.
Remarkable musicians, great students, great conductors, and the orchestra was happy to play under their leadership.
Music flowed from inside these grand gates for hundreds of years. The Sheremetyev Palace was the site of many concerts and balls in St. Petersburg. The Sheremetyev family owned the home for 5 generations. They were fabulously wealthy, owning at one point up to 200,000 serfs. Now it is partly a museum of music.
Longest instrument, about 6 meters.
As curator, Professor Vladimir Koshelov provided the University of Georgia visitors a private tour.
I mean, this guy had one of the most extensive collections I think that exists in general. Just to see all the different, the variations that each one of these instruments has gone through. There was a cage probably had 200 something different kinds of oboes in it, from like old style French hautbois all the way through the modern oboe that we know today and everything in between.
The museum is a paradise for musicologists and conductors. There are rows and cases of antique instruments from not only Russia, but Asia, the Middle East, and Europe.
One glass casing would take you 100 years in the development of certain instruments, and there's nothing like it. I've never seen an instrument museum as comprehensive as that. It was truly fascinating.
It's glass, stained glass, crystal.
So it's a crystal flute with ruby octave keys or some kind of pink.
Yes, it's playable. The professor demonstrated a few rare instruments for his special guest.
I can a little bit tune. Yeah.
No one in this group had ever seen a Russian horn orchestra.
Kind of like a handbell choir, that every pitch was a different instrument that they had to play into. So I'd never seen that before.
You imagine these serfs practicing for hours and hours to play symphonies with these horns. It's amazing.
And instruments of Nikolai the First, because Nikolai the First was a trumpeter. Uh-huh. And we have documents, one time he played in a public concert.
Dr. Foreman was attracted to a cabinet linked to Alexander III, the Tsar Jules Levy would eventually play his cornet for in Russia.
So this tuba was the actual tuba that Alexander III played. Vladimir said that this little gold brass horn here, the signal horn, Alexander III played when he was a child, which may have been why he took an interest in brass instruments and learned to play the cornet and the tuba.
The tour ended with a better understanding of ancient instruments and an invitation.
Come to see us in Georgia.
Yes.
Yeah.
In 1710, just a few years after St. Petersburg was founded, craftsmen built the Alexander Nevsky Monastery. The monastery complex housed 16 churches. Now, only 5 remain. One of the group's most memorable visits was to an elaborate cemetery adjacent to the monastery.
And I remember we walked into the entrance of the cemetery and there was sort of a crowd and we were instructed to move out of the way and we didn't know why. It was because there was a procession of these Orthodox priests coming through and seeing them in their robes, it looked like it was going back in time.
The giants of 19th century Russian music are buried in the Tikhvin Cemetery.
It's like every major 19th century Russian composer is buried here. Tchaikovsky, Rimsky-Korsakov, Borodin, Glinka.
You know, when you walk in, it's you know you're in a special ground. So now we can look at just a sense of honor, how they honor the people from their past that have come to write their cultural history.
For Dr. Foreman, this cemetery visit reminded him of when he first studied Russian music in college.
When I first studied Russian music at the university, I had a very inspiring teacher. His name was Edward Williams. It's like, I don't know, somehow rounding the circle, you know, because you study and you read, you listen to the music of these people, and, you know, you're doing it in Lawrence, Kansas. I was at the University of Kansas. You never really dream that you're going to be here, and then all of a sudden you are, and it's amazing. It's wonderful.
When I describe our journey to Russia, the one thing that always comes up is our journey to the Peterhof. It was unbelievable.
Outside of St. Petersburg, on the southern shore of the Gulf of Finland, stands one of the most majestic sites in Russia. Peterhof. The palace is built on a bluff, making the entryway from the sea that much more impressive after getting off a hydrofoil ferry.
Despite the weather, it was raining and cloudy, but it added this sort of mysterious element to the whole compound.
Peterhof is a labyrinth of palaces, fountains, and seemingly endless gardens. For the imperial families, it was a summertime escape from the city of St. Petersburg.
Fountains of water everywhere and gold abound, like it was someone's treasure, like someone was hiding it from the rest of the world.
Peter the Great started building his palace in 1714 after an inspiring trip to France. Peterhof is often dubbed the Russian Versailles. Each Tsar expanded the 1,500-acre palatial complex, adding homes and a series of fountains. It became a decadent playground for the royal families.
One of the coolest things I saw was this little river that led up to the palace, and in the river was a golden swan. Like you see it in some cheesy cartoon, two lovebirds and a swan, you know. But this is all gold and like crystal things on them where you can fit maybe like three or four people on. And I thought, oh, that's really cool. I always saw that in like fantasy cartoons growing up, but to see it in real life, it really does exist.
One of the technical achievements at Peterhof is all the fountains operate without the use of pumps. The University of Georgia graduate students marveled at the Grand Cascade. In the middle is a statue of the biblical figure Samson fighting a lion. The statue was stolen by Nazi troops during World War II. Hitler's troops razed the palace and left it to burn. Russians later entirely reconstructed the palace's splendor.
You know, the paintings were 20 feet by 40 feet. I mean, just these gigantic murals that were, you know, depicting war scenes and battles and honoring the family members. And we saw where there was damage and repair damage from World War II bombings. So I think to step into rooms that were affected by these historical events that obviously didn't impact us, you know, on the land in America was really fascinating.
As the UGA group strolled the grounds, Dr. Foreman explained how cornetist Jules Levy perhaps walked the same paths.
Hard to imagine this being for one family.
In the 19th century, walking races were a form of recreation. Despite being short, the Englishman was so fast, no one could keep up at Peterhof. The egotistical Levy knew how to entertain his Russian audience in more ways than one at this palace.
He was going down a hall, and he met coming toward him this very large man, and he said, with a beautiful small woman. And he took them to be husband and wife, but he had no idea who they were. And so he, walked on by. Well, it turns out that was Alexander. That was the Tsarevich, which was a great, would have been a great faux pas to not have treated him with proper respect. But Alexander realized that Levy didn't know who he was.
Levy had won an invitation to Peterhof after impressing the right people in Russia. He played his cornet for about 150 people, dukes, duchesses, and princes, including the future Tsar, Alexander III. Alexander was a very large man with a gruff and straightforward manner. He would later become an autocratic, conservative Tsar, just like his grandfather, Nicholas I. But on this occasion, Levy charmed Alexander so much, the future Tsar gave him a gold ring.
And the next time Levy saw Alexander, it talks about him almost rushing up, running up, and grabbing his hand and shaking it and thanking him for the ring and exclaiming, he said, "I took it to a jeweler and it's worth 400 rubles," which, everybody thought was really funny and naive that Levy would just be concerned about the price of that.
Alexander III would give Levy an even more stunning honor. The future Tsar asked Levy to become an honorary member of a brass band made up of Russian counts and generals.
In Russia, there is a tradition of bringing foreign musicians and famous virtuosos for the purposes of performing in concert halls. But specifically, the Grand Dukes and the Tsars would not perform with these foreign virtuosos themselves. And the fact that Alexander III played with Jules Levy was indeed a highly unusual occurrence. Levy obviously charmed the Tsar with his performance.
Alexander III and his Imperial Court Band rehearsed at the Admiralty Building, the headquarters of the Russian Navy.
They would meet on Thursday nights, practice a couple of hours, and then have these lavish banquets about 11 o'clock or midnight, and stay and eat and drink till 3 or 4 in the morning and go home. And so Levy played as a member of that group for several months.
Only a few blocks away is the Tsar's Winter Palace, one of St. Petersburg's architectural jewels. Generations of royal families call this home. One side of the Winter Palace is bordered by the bustling Neva River, the other by an enormous square.
It was massive, the amount of square feet of that plaza. I mean, I felt you could fit thousands of people in there.
Thousands have crowded into Palace Square throughout history. One of the more famous during the October Revolution of 1917, when Bolsheviks stormed the Winter Palace and seized power. A red granite spire, topped by a lone angel, is the focal point in Palace Square. Nicholas I created this monument in 1934 in memory of his brother's victory over Napoleon. In an engineering feat, 3,000 men set the column upright without the use of modern cranes. Today, Palace Square serves as a tourist mecca. The UGA group enjoyed a few photo ops before entering the Winter Palace and the adjoining art museum complex called the Hermitage.
It was a long line. But once I got in, I really understood. I mean, there was art in there that I remember looking at in an art history textbook when I took art history in high school and college, and here is in front of me live. And I love French impressionistic art, and I saw a lot of that.
Such a variety.
I think they said something like it, if you walked around to each exhibit for like 15 seconds or something, it would take you 9+ years to get through the entire museum.
In the day, this is the 3D movie.
I can't even imagine congregating that much stuff. I mean, it's fantastic art. And everything from, you know, a sculpture the size of my pinky finger to a painting that takes up 3 stories. It was really incredible, and it's cool to see because they have a lot of stuff by major artists. I mean, really important things that never get seen because it's in Russia.
That is in really good condition.
Each czar, most notably Catherine the Great, collected the best art from around the globe. It was intended only for the eyes of the royals and designated visitors. Until an unexpected event in 1837. A huge fire broke out at the Winter Palace. It burned for 3 days. Tsar Nicholas I saved much of the priceless art inside the adjacent hermitage by creating a fire break. Later, he ordered the palace interiors rebuilt and in 1852 opened Russia's first public art gallery. Visitors entered the new hermitage through a portico supported by 10 granite figures of Atlantis. As a museum visitor, evening dress was required, even in the morning. Today, thousands of visitors wander through the intricately decorated passages, marveling at the grandeur of the art and the opulence of the architecture. The Hermitage complex is one of the world's largest museums. Even with a map, the UGA graduate students found it difficult not to get lost. But Russians reached out to help strangers in a strange land.
Okay.
Straight and по кругу. Right, right, и вот так все посмотрите.
Спасибо.
After soaking up centuries of art history, the group emerged back into daylight. They took a moment in Palace Square to return to reality and their roots with a University of Georgia football chant.
Go Dogs! Sick 'em!
The UGA group traveled by train from St. Petersburg to Moscow. The rail line is one of the oldest in Russia. Nicholas I ordered the track constructed in 1842. 10 years later, serfs completed the grueling task. For passengers today, the ride provides an opportunity to become acquainted with new friends and view the countryside.
Going through the Northwest. Before coming to Georgia, I lived in Seattle. And so the greenery and that kind of seeing overcast clouds with beautiful evergreen trees, that a lot of the foliage was there from St. Petersburg into Russia, which makes sense because it's along the same latitude.
3 hours later, Moscow emerges from the landscape. This capital city of 11 million people created a whole different impression upon the University of Georgia graduate students.
I learned that people with money and want to have more of a cosmopolitan lifestyle lived in St. Petersburg, whereas Moscow was a typical big city, more of an industry city. It reminded me of like a Detroit.
Then when we had that, she had many favorites.
Letters.
So Moscow is the business area and has the more modern, you know, the ads and the billboards and all that kind of stuff in the dense center, the inner populated area. And then it just gets real kind of sketchy as you get farther away from that center.
Moscow is named for the river that winds through its interior. Along that river, in the very heart of the city, is the dominant feature of the state, the Kremlin. The Kremlin is a vast complex of churches and palaces, some dating back to the 15th century. For generations, czars were crowned, married, and buried here.
Every inch of the wall covered with beautiful paintings, looking like maybe from the 1500s or earlier, and just seeing the amount of care that the artist took to make this place of worship really special. And to see the tombs of all the czars is pretty imposing as well.
As the seat of political power during the communist era, government rulers lived and worked inside the walled complex, encircled by a shroud of secrecy. It was only following Stalin's death that the complex became partially open to the public.
It's incredible as an American to have the opportunity to be in the Kremlin. I mean, decades ago we were not able to do this. It's very moving and exciting at the same time, and it's absolutely beautiful.
Tourists crowd around attractions like the bronze Tsar cannon or the Tsar bell, the world's largest. The bell weighs more than 200 tons and dwarfs anyone beside it. The bell never really rang from any bell tower. It had problems during its casting in the 18th century, and a huge slab actually broke off after workers threw cold water on it after a fire. Leaving the Kremlin, the University of Georgia group made their way through bustling plazas filled with fountains to yet another symbolic site.
I remember we were walking up a brick road, and it was this long journey to the top of the hill, and at the very top, as you top the crest of the hill, you can see St. Basil's in the distance. And I vividly remember that experience because that's the trademark, you know, view of Russia.
Standing on one end of Red Square, the colorful onion domes of St. Basil's Cathedral gratify the creative eye.
You can't fully understand it until you're standing in it. I mean, you can look at pictures all day and watch YouTube videos all day, but until you're standing right in the center with those massive buildings and the domes, it's kind of funny. It looks like a castle out of like a Candyland game or something.
The Grand Prince of Moscow, Ivan the Terrible, commissioned the cathedral in the 16th century. According to legend, the Russian leader blinded the architect afterwards, so the craftsman would never design anything quite so beautiful. Visitors can tour the cathedral, wandering a maze of chapels decorated with geometric designs and religious artwork. Red Square was once considered a sacred place, used for religious processions and executions. During the communist era, military parades took the place of religious pageants. Despite the rain, the University of Georgia group absorbed all the different sites within Red Square.
That's one of the most stunning places I've ever seen on the planet. When you enter the square, it's like a sense of awe.
The UGA visitors listened to a guide explain the square's history while they soaked up the culture and the crowds.
It's cool to, you know, stand there and take selfies in front of the St. Basil's Cathedral and put them on Instagram and, hey, look where I am.
But the group received an unexpected taste of military presence.
The one thing that was sort of a scary moment was being approached by KGB officers.
Different agents in plain clothes would come out and like flash their KGB badge, and I obviously don't know what they're saying, but Igor and them would get into this yelling match, and Stu would have to put the camera down.
We learned after that he was questioning our camera crew for being there, and that he thought it was a commercial thing. And I thought to myself, you know, I thought this was a public square. Like, you don't go to our Washington, D.C. monuments and have, you know, FBI agents approaching you.
Scaffolding rose up like giant abstract art on one side of the square. Many exhibitions and concerts are held in this wide open space. Ironically, a nearby band played a tune that University of Georgia visitors would instantly recognize. The song, Georgia on My Mind. People from all over the world flock to this city square. It's a people-watching bonanza. Red Square is surrounded by architecturally striking buildings. Churches, museums, and even a high-end mall.
And then we went in that mall. There's a giant, another structure on the third side that they turned into kind of a ritzy, I mean, really ritzy, not like, yeah, it's like FIPS times 100. That was kind of a wake-up call for what that city really is. I mean, it's one of the more wealthy cities, the heart of Moscow itself, that 1 mile radius from the center is packed in with some of the most wealthy people in the world. So it was interesting to kind of see that next to what it used to be. You know, old world meets new world, and they kind of clash in the middle, Red Square, ironically. So I thought that was neat.
While in Moscow, the young conductors received a special privilege, touring an elite music school called the Gnesin Russian Academy of Music. Lining the walls are photographs of famous musicians who attended the academy. Several sisters opened the conservatory in 1895. A woman director still runs the academy. Through a translator, she and other professors asked questions about the University of Georgia's music program.
We have 6 concert bands, a marching band, a basketball band, a jazz band, 2 symphony orchestras, and a jazz orchestra.
The University of Georgia has one of the largest band programs in the United States.
They were surprised and astonished at what it was like to get a degree in conducting here in America in the way that we do with sort of the gesture mixed with working with ensembles, but also taking music theory and history. And so they were really interested to know how we approached things.
A special guest at the table was a Russian general, the commander of all the military bands of the Russian armed forces.
He said, you know, why do American military bands and parades march trombones in the front? And I thought, well, it's because the slides, you know, when you want to hit people in front of you, so you have them in front because you don't have anyone to hit. And he said, well, that's not right. At this point, I'm like, oh, well, you know, musically, they should be backed by the tubas and for balance. And he said, that's the only thing about American military bands I don't agree with is the trombones marching in the front rank of the block. I said, oh, well, that's different, you know.
The group gave each other small gifts. Later, Dr. Lynch tried out the acoustics in the conservatory's dazzling concert hall.
What I love about it is that they cared about the music as much as we did, and they cared about the students as much as we did. And they were so open to creating a relationship with the University of Georgia.
That relationship with the Gnesin Academy would later bear fruit back home in Athens, Georgia.
From an early age, Rickey Badua knew music would accent his life. A piano teacher asked him a pivotal question at age 4.
I remember when she asked me if I wanted to continue to play piano and music, that was a no-brainer for me. As a kid, I said, yeah, of course. I feel it's easy, like it's fun. I enjoy it, and like it's like playtime for me.
For these 3 conducting students, it's the same tune, different instrument.
I remember in 4th grade, it was just summertime, and I was just kind of hanging around the house, and we had lots of musical instruments in our home because my mom was a music teacher. So there was a guitar there, and I just thought, I'm gonna pick that up and just kind of mess around with it. And it just clicked so fast for me, and I just, you know, looking back, I knew that was a sign, and I knew I felt a connection to music.
I play euphonium, which is kind of like a small tuba. I got into playing, really started band in 6th grade and hooked, doing it ever since.
The graduate students are from different parts of the country. Rickey from the paradise of Hawaii, Curran Prendergast from the nation's heartland, Iowa, and Blake Unger, a Georgia native from an Atlanta suburb, Norcross. While each young conductor plays a favorite instrument, they must thoroughly know every instrument's voice in order to lead an orchestra or band.
Everybody thinks, oh, you just get up there and you wave your hands and that's the degree you're getting. Well, it's a little more complicated than that.
The students have served as graduate assistants in the Hugh Hodgson School of Music at the University of Georgia.
It's a big production here with a lot of stuff happening, you know, a lot of wheels turning.
But the preparation for a very special concert of rare Russian-related music proved particularly intense. Before the rehearsals ever began, there came this. A computer software program called Finale.
The technology has advanced so far that the sounds are so close. I mean, as close as you can get without actually having instruments. At this point, they're so close to sounding like the real thing that it allows you to get a sense of what it will sound like almost in real life. I mean, nothing replicates the acoustics of real music making, but this program is amazing because it allows you to get a sense of what it would be like. You can insert all kinds of different notes, dynamics, articulations, clefs, I mean, anything that you would write, be able to write with a pen and pencil. It'll bring up new windows for all 24 of the instruments.
It is a process that would make the composers of yesteryear envious. Tedious handwriting is replaced with cut, copy, paste. The graduate students use the notation software to transform the music from a Russian archive into a modern-day performance.
I mean, all of what I put my hands on just, you know, had the DNA of Rossini, and I could hear his light opera sounds just within this little march I was working with, and that was really cool.
Even with today's technology, the graduate students spent weeks dedicated to this editing process. While Rickey and Curran tackled Rossini's military marches, Blake arranged a piece for a quintet written by an anonymous Russian composer. The students' challenge was to take the original music from the 19th century and recreate it for modern instruments, using the notes composed in the 1800s, but with a modern sound.
And to try and remain true to Rossini's, the colors that he used with the blending of certain instruments, so that we kind of retain that within the modern concert band.
The catch? Some instruments used in the 19th century no longer exist.
All of the instruments as we know them really began to evolve during the early 19th century, or the first half of the 19th century, at the same time as we call the Industrial Revolution. So they invented the valve, the piston valve, for example, that we know today on trumpets and euphoniums. So the instruments really evolved about, you know, 1820s, 30s, 40s. But a lot of this music we're looking at was written before that. We didn't at that point, for example, have tubas, because tuba hadn't been invented yet. So the bass parts, or the low voice in the band, would have been taken by perhaps a serpent, which is a an extinct sort of instrument that played sort of a S-shaped curved wooden thing.
Rossini wrote the three military marches for Tsar Nicholas I. Strangely enough, even with the stature of a composer like Rossini.
And it's possible that no one heard the piece when it was originally given to Nicholas I in the 1830s. That these marches were written by Rossini as a gift, as a kind of a gesture to Nicholas I. And it's sometimes these were just more formal, wrapped in ribbon or something, given to the Tsar, and then he just kept that in his own personal collection and was never performed.
Nicholas I reveled in military drills and almost anything military related. So why would the military marches possibly not be played for him? In the Russian archives, Dr. Foreman says there are only scores for the music, not individual parts for each instrument.
My thought is that they went straight into the cabinet and the Tsar sent Rossini a gold ring as an expression, a token of his appreciation, and I think that was the end of it. So I don't think he ever heard these marches.
Nicholas's brother, former Tsar Alexander I, gave Rossini a pair of diamond cufflinks a decade earlier as a sign of appreciation for a concert. But Nicholas I was a more austere Tsar. While he hosted lavish balls at the Winter Palace, some with up to 40,000 guests, he was generally not noted for his generosity. The celebrated opera idol Rossini may have expected more from the Russian emperor.
He received a ring, but it was valued less than what Rossini hoped for. It was just a formal gift and not the sign of respect that Rossini expected, considering the gifts he received from other European monarchs.
Even though Rossini may have been disappointed with a gift, Jules Levy was not. Instead, he was delighted by a lavish present from a Russian prince. Prince Oldenburg played in Alexander III's private band. When Levy joined the band in 1872, the prince gave him a gold-plated cornet surrounded by 200 turquoise stones. Another band member later described Levy's eccentric and colorful behavior.
He liked our circle so much that he played with us for a whole 2 months, amusing us with his audacious escapades of a purely American nature. He turned out to be one of the most tireless and helpful orchestra players. With a single eyeglass, he had the gestures and manners that reminded more of a circus performer with a whip in his hands.
The animated Levy would later help out no less than American inventor Thomas Edison. In 1878, Edison demonstrated his new invention, the phonograph, in a concert hall in New York City.
So they had a phonograph on the stage. Levy played into it. They recorded what he played, and then they played it back to the amazed audience.
Levy had experience impressing American audiences. A few years before, he had toured the country with famous bandmaster Patrick Gilmore. Levy joined Gilmore's band after trying his own hand at selling concert tickets. He eventually abandoned the effort and stiffed some concert managers. That scandal came back to haunt him during a performance in Detroit.
When Levy came off of the stage, he was met by the sheriff who said, "You owe this other concert hall $300 because you didn't honor that contract." And Levy refused to pay, and they took that jeweled cornet from him. And a week later, it was sold at public auction.
Dr. Foreman thought the instrument had simply vanished.
About a year ago, I learned pretty much by accident that that instrument is actually in a museum in Grand Rapids, Michigan. So we have found it. So it's a bit satisfying to know maybe that you can't have it, but so you're not going to go prowling in all the antique shops. But to know where it is and to know that it does exist is, you know, that's satisfying.
In small, intimate theaters in St. Petersburg, audiences are transported to a fantasy land, just as they once were in the 19th century, the golden age of Russian opera.
We were so close in like a little shoebox kind of theater, but the energy, I felt like I was way more connected to the performers on stage and the energy of the room. The humor was way more visceral and way more, the action was way more engaging than being in a large opera theater like the Mariinsky Theater. And there was a value to that too, because I've never been in one like that.
The University of Georgia conductors strive to incorporate all of the sights and sounds of Russia's culture into their musical translations.
You want to convey more than just notes on the page. just like an artist wants to convey more than just colors on a canvas. And to really accurately convey those things, I think you need to understand them. And so you're the only link, you're the only tunnel, the only connector, the conduit from Russia to them. And so I think it's important that people have that understanding and that knowledge. And if we're going to be the ones to bring back the music, we need to bring back everything else that goes with it. And that's a big thing.
All their hard work culminated in a concert at the University of Georgia. For the first time, a Western audience would hear music by the opera superstar Rossini, composed for a Russian Tsar 180 years ago.
So, you know, I think when an audience will hear it, I really think they're going to hear themselves, oh, Rossini, yeah, that sounds like Rossini. That sounds like it could be a little march in one of his operas that we've heard before.
If Rossini had sat in this audience,
I think he would have loved his march. I think he would have never imagined it to sound that certain way.
In his arrangement, Curran took the score's 14 different lines and expanded it to 21, fleshing out the woodwind and brass sections.
I remember seeing the original Rossini ink on the page of the Asoda Varsovy that I had transcribed, and just thinking, you know, I'm holding what Rossini used to write the march. And that made me feel like I was connected to him in a way. And so it brought a lot of, I don't know, sort of honor to the process. And I wanted to make sure that I was honoring him in his work with this march.
The concert in Athens was only the first step in bringing the music to a wider audience.
This is take number one, starting at the beginning.
There's a lot of tweaking and fine-tuning that's going to go into that CD, and a lot of it has to do with the comments that we wrote down that day.
We think the potential of the Rossini in particular to take off is very great because band directors and bands are always seeking original repertoire by significant composers of historic importance.
Producers recorded a CD featuring the new Rossini pieces, as well as Blake's quintet. Curran sent his performance copy of the Rossini March to their new Russian friend, the conductor of the Admiralty Navy Band.
When I finished making the arrangement and the parts, I could save them as a PDF file and then send them to him so that he could print it off in Russia and hand it his player. So it allows us to really communicate and get the music all over the world.
Some members of the Knessen Russian Academy of Music traveled from Moscow to Athens, attending a concert and strengthening the relationship between the two music schools.
Papers will be signed that could eventually lead to exchanges of students, faculties, or whatever, another outgrowth of that trip, which was completely unexpected.
Dr. Foreman's relationship with the Russian Institute for the History of Arts allowed the graduate students rare access to musical treasures.
The volume of music in that museum is staggering. I think there's a lot to be looked at, even more than we were fortunate enough to see. So I know that there would be future projects that we could, you know, if they're willing to continue to cooperate, that would be great to bring more of this music to life.
Now, the Institute in St. Petersburg is eager for more collaboration.
It always makes me happy when compositions that were not played for a long time are played again, be it in America or in Russia. I think that it will be a very beneficial and interesting partnership with a university that is more than 200 years old.
Outside the Institute, this Tsar, astride a horse, is hearing perhaps for the first time military marches composed for him, marches that will now be shared around the globe.
I hope personally that it will be a way of showing people that there's just an awful lot of interesting music yet to be discovered. We may think we know everything there is to know about music of the 19th century, but it's just not the case.
The rhythms of Russia will vibrate inside these young conductors for years to come, finding a frequency as they begin new careers teaching and conducting bands in high schools and colleges.
I think going to Russia has metaphorically deepened my pool of experience, of life, of culture, of, you know, music, of everything that we saw and did over there. It's deepened that pool, and so now I bring that extra 5 inches of depth to anything that I interact with other musicians with, or study, or work on. And I think that's your job. That's my job, that's Rickey's job, Curran, Dr. Lynch. We got that experience so that those extra inches of depth are shown in everything else that we're involved in from here forward.
The detective work of one man tracking a musician unraveled other stories inside Russia, connecting composers and czars, superstars of the 19th century who lived in different lands.
Who would ever think that, I'm going to go to Russia to find out what Jules Levy did, and what you would end up with is finding these 3 marches by Rossini, and then being privileged to be part of the process of bringing those out and hearing them played by bands, maybe for the first time ever. It's a great way to go. It really is.
Золотыми солнцами.